The Spirit and the church cry out, "Come, Lord Jesus." That is our Advent prayer, the prayer of God's people of all time. From the Old Testament, "Come, Messiah, come, Lord Jesus." For the Old Testament church, that was their prayer. New Testament church, our prayer is, "Come again, Lord Jesus," or "Come quickly, Lord Jesus." And so both the Old and New Testament church, God's people have always been praying for the coming of Christ. That's what Advent is all about. Come, Lord Jesus. As we focus today on that first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ, we are taught a lesson to wait from our psalm today. Psalm 25 is the appointed psalm this first Sunday in Advent. And we'll learn a lesson in waiting, like waiting for us to start worship while we resolved a minor technical difficulty. You are all so patient, appreciate that. And we'll talk more about waiting in other types of places in our lives today in our message. Our order of service is going to be up on the screen for us. Would you please rise for our invocation? Brothers and sisters in Christ, we gather today for worship in the name of the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh, God's beloved, let us come before God, our Father, with repentant hearts and confess our sins to him, asking in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that he grant forgiveness to us. For God's word says, when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. Together we confess, God of mercy, I know that I am sinful by nature. I sin against you in what I think, say, and do, in ways that I know and in ways of which I am unaware. As an impatient sinner, I turn to my own plans and desires. Instead of waiting for you, O Lord, I fail to trust that your timing is perfect. I ask for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, to forgive me for this and for all the ways in which I have done wrong against you. Upon hearing your confession, I, by virtue of my office, as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The congregation may be seated. Be with you all. Let us pray together. The collect of the day is printed on the screen. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come, that by your protection we may be rescued from the threatening perils of our sins and saved by your mighty deliverance. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Old Testament that greets us this first Sunday of Advent is from the prophet Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days, at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will dwell securely. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. For what thanksgiving can we return to God for you? For all the joy that we feel for your sake before our God, as we pray most earnestly night and day that we may see you face to face and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of Lord Jesus with all his saints. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 21st chapter. And there will be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars and on the earth, distress of nations in perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and of the waves, people fainting with fear and with foreboding of what is coming on the world. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. And he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees, and as soon as they become out in leaf, you see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all this has taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But watch yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with the dissipation and drunkenness and cares of this life, and that day come upon you suddenly like a trap. For it will come upon all who dwell on the face of the whole earth. But stay awake at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that are going to take place and to stand before the Son of Man. This is the gospel of our Lord. The congregation may be seated for our children's message led by Mrs. Bryant, our second grade teacher. And this time we invite her and all the children forward.
Good morning. How are you? Did you have a good Thanksgiving? Well, I need your help this morning. In about a month, I get to go see my mom and dad in St. Louis. Isn't that exciting? I have to drive a long way, but I'm really excited, so I've been packing, and I need your help to make sure that I have all of the things that I need. Rebecca, this is one of my favorite bags. We use it a lot. I think it was actually Mr. Bryant's when we were in college. Okay, you want to hold this for a minute? Thanks. Okay. Okay, are you ready? I have a sweater, you know, because it's going to be December when I go there. What do you think? Am I doing okay so far? I have a sweater. Perfect. Okay. I brought a flip-flop. What do you think? Would that work?
No.
No? Why not? It's going to be cold. How many feet do you have?
Two.
How many shoes do I have?
One.
I think I'm missing the other shoe, and maybe they're not the right choice. Okay, but I know the next thing is something my mom always tells me to pack. What's this?
A toothbrush.
I'm so excited. Am I ready? Am I all packed? Is my bag ready?
No.
Oh, guys, I don't know about this. I'm so excited to go see my mom and dad and my brother and his wife and their kiddos. Yes, Brooks, tell me. I do have to pick up after myself when I'm playing with my toys. You guys know, I am so excited. I'm really trying to be ready ahead of time. But I'm not prepared, am I? I'm not prepared. I'm not ready. Well, you know what? You and I are also preparing for something. Do you know what we're preparing for? We're preparing for heaven. That's excellent. And we're preparing for Jesus. It's gonna be Christmas time. It's Advent. Have you noticed the church looks a little different? Advent means to prepare, to get ready. So I didn't do a great job of getting ready to go to my mom and dad's house. But how do you and I get ready for Christmas? How do we get ready for Jesus to be born as a baby and to come back? Kyler, how do we get ready? We put up a Christmas tree for sure, yes. We decorate the house. What do we do inside of ourselves to get ready? How do we get our hearts and our minds ready? Can you think of anything? Yeah. We sing Christmas songs because they're a lot of times about Jesus. And pick up our toys. Brooks, I can tell you've been working on that at home. I'm very proud of you. What about reading God's word? Is it important to read the Bible? For sure. Okay, what about coming to church? Is that important? That's where we hear about Jesus. What about doing a Bible study with our family, reading a devotion before dinner at night? Is that another good way to get ready? Because we want to get our hearts ready for Jesus to come, don't we? I want to read to you a Bible verse as soon as I figure out where I set my Bible. Oh, it's right here. This Bible verse, it says, wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Are you and I waiting for Jesus? Yeah, we have some work to do to get ready. But because of the Holy Spirit, we are definitely going to be ready. Would you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for helping me to be ready for you at Christmas time and in the future when you come back. Please be with me and help me get my heart ready. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Upon hearing the gospel of our Lord and that wonderful children's message, let's stand and confess our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed in preparation for Christ's arrival. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds,
God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Congregation may be seated for the sermon.
Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Remember your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. Here ends our text. The Spirit and the Church cry out, "Come, Lord Jesus." Grace, mercy, and peace from our God and Father and our coming Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Waiting for the Lord. Well, I'm glad to be back from vacation. We had a wonderful week. Our family had a great time. We took off last Sunday after church. Last Sunday afternoon, we took off, drove to Omaha, got on an airplane. We flew to Miami. We got into Miami a little after midnight, and then left Monday morning on a cruise ship. Well, Monday, boarded a cruise ship Monday afternoon. Then we left on the cruise ship. And then we got back to Miami Friday morning. We got off our cruise ship, and I got in line at the rental car counter that was longer than the city of Battle Creek. The line stretched probably a couple of miles. And then we got to, and we drove around Miami for a day, most of the day, and then we got back to the airport to catch our flight home. And the line at security, I thought the line at the rental car line was long. The line at security, longer. Then we got on the airplane, and we sat down, and we got buckled in. And then the captain came on the PA system, and he said, "There's a little computer problem. We're going to have to wait for our clearance to get underway." And then we sat there on the airplane for a little over an hour. Now, thankfully, home, you know, got back to Battle Creek, got in bed about 3:30. Saturday morning, so I've almost caught up on sleep. Talk to me by Tuesday, okay? But there's a lot of waiting over that trip, waiting to get into the cruise terminal, you know, with traveling with an unvaccinated 11-year-old. That is a long process. Waiting to get on the cruise ship, waiting to get the car at the car rental counter, waiting to get through security. You know, I hear a lot of people have problems with waiting because the longer we waited, the more frustrated people in line would get. And I learned something in that process when you yell at the TSA agent because it's taking so long, it does not speed things up. Right? The grumpier you get in the car rental counter does not make the line go faster. And the guy who was sitting behind us on the airplane as we were approaching Omaha, and he said, "Just land already. Stop teasing me." And I went around and say, "We're still in Iowa. Do you want to make it to Omaha or not?" But all these lessons in waiting and patience. You see, you kids nowadays, you have no idea what patience really is. Waiting, right? When I was your age, listen to me. Listen to me. When I was your age, took a picture, you had to wait 3 days to get it back and see what it looked like. I know. Gee, do you need medical attention? Are you going to be okay? When I was your age and you wanted to put ketchup on your tray for your fries, listen to this. You had to get the bottle of ketchup. You had to turn it over. Find a way to leave it there. Went outside, built a snow fort, came back in, and you would have one drop of ketchup. Because we didn't have squeeze bottles. That's a lesson in patience, waiting for the ketchup. Now, we had all kinds of interesting ways to try to get the ketchup out of the bottle faster. You know, take a knife, stick it in the ketchup bottle. That'll maybe break the surface tension of the ketchup and help it flow out faster. Because you know what helps things flow faster? When you put something else in the way. That didn't work. All right, I want to shake the ketchup bottle and stuff will come flying out all over the kitchen. And my impatience creates a bigger mess. You know, the company who made the ketchup bottles, they even had a slogan to try to make you feel better about this process. Anybody remember what they used to teach you? Good things come to those who wait. Wow. That's the word of the Lord, isn't it? Could be, almost. Good things come to those who wait. Patience, waiting for God to act, waiting for God to do his thing, waiting for God to fulfill his promises. The Bible is full of a waiting game, waiting for God to come through on what he promised in Genesis 3, that he would send a Messiah, that he would send one who would crush the serpent's head. Waiting throughout the entire Old Testament, with every birth, with every prophecy, with every moment, waiting for God to fulfill that promise. And then we get to Bethlehem, and there it is, the promise fulfilled. And now what? Waiting again. Waiting for the next promise, the last promise to be fulfilled. Waiting for the Christ to come again to deliver us from this veil of tears to be with himself for eternity. Waiting for Christ to come to judge the living and the dead and to bring us to eternal paradise with him. Waiting. It's a waiting game. Christianity is all about waiting. Waiting for the Lord. Waiting for these promises to be fulfilled. And we are terrible waiters. I don't mean to say that none of us can serve drinks well. I mean that we are terrible at waiting. We are terrible at being patient. We just can't wait. We need the instant digital photography. We need the 1 hour photo prints. We need the fast food lines. We need all of the immediate gratification that comes from a squeeze bottle of ketchup or mayonnaise. That's my least, yeah. The squeeze bottle. We need these things that just make our life go faster because we don't know how to wait. And we grow impatient with God too. God, when are you going to answer my prayer? God, when are you going to come and fix this problem? I learned in church to give it to you in prayer, to take it to the Lord in prayer. When are you going, God, to answer my prayer? When are you going to give me a better job? When are you going to give me a better income? When are you going to heal the brokenness in my family? When are you going to heal and cure the disease, the sickness in my loved one? When are you going to make things better? When are you going to hear and answer and fix all of my problems, God? When are you going to keep your promise to never leave me or forsake me? Because it sure feels like I'm all alone. God, when are you going to keep up your end of this bargain? And our impatience drives us a little further and further and further away from our God. Let me tell you a biblical story about this very phenomenon. There was a guy named Saul. He was a strong warrior. He was the kind of king you'd want if you wanted a king. You see, for an entire generation, God's people had been crying out to God, give us a king like all the other nations have. And God had told them through his messengers, you don't want to have a king. Kings are not good for you. I'll be your king, God had told the Israelites. And they said, no, we want a king. And so God gave him a king. As he worked through the prophet Samuel to anoint Saul to be king, there he was, rough and ready. He was a man's man, and he was a king's king. They had a rule for King Saul. Before you go into battle, Saul, wait for the priests. Wait for Samuel and the other priests to come and anoint the army. Consecrate the army for battle. And this worked every time. Samuel would come, the priests would come, they would pray, they would consecrate the army would go into battle, and they were undefeated. Saul led some of the greatest military victories with the power of God and the work of these consecrating priests. And then here come the ferocious Philistines. And they amount an army at Gilgal. And Saul calls together all of his forces. It's going to take the whole army to defeat these ferocious Philistines. And he gets the whole army together, and he summons Samuel to come and consecrate the army. And he's waiting for Samuel. The army is dressed for action. They've got their armor on. They've got their swords and axes in their hands. They are ready for battle. All they're waiting for is Samuel to come, for the priest to come to consecrate the army and put him into battle. And they are there waiting for Samuel. And there was evening and there was morning the first day. No Samuel. The next day, the army's ready, waiting for Samuel, no Samuel. And so they waited all through the second day, and the third day, and the fourth day, and the fifth day, and the sixth day, and still no Samuel. Still no priests, still no one of the priests of God have come to consecrate the army. And Saul's getting restless. Some of his soldiers are getting restless and leaving. Some of the soldiers have said, well, if we're not going to fight, we're going back home. And they're leaving the battlegrounds. And Saul is growing a little uneasy. Some big army across the way there. These Philistines are indeed ferocious. We can't lose any more of our troops. Samuel's nowhere to be found. And so Saul takes matters into his own hands. Even though he is not authorized as a priest of God to offer sacrifices, he goes and offers a sacrifice to consecrate his army. And in God's mighty, powerful sense of drama, right after Saul consecrates his army, guess what happens? Samuel shows up. The prophet of God. Saul, what have you done? Why have you defied the Lord in offering up a sacrifice? Because you have done this, your army will fall. And Saul ignores Samuel completely, marches his army against the Philistines, and suffers his first defeat. Saul ends up fleeing for his life from the Philistines at Gilgal that day, all because he couldn't wait for God in his time. All because of his impatience, he suffers. Because he takes matters into his own hands, because he tries to force God's hand at work, because he tries to take things for himself and not patiently wait for the Lord, Saul makes a mess of his army, and it gets worse. Samuel says to Saul, "Because you have done this, because you have disobeyed the Lord is taking away your kingdom. The Lord is now searching for a new king who will rule after God's own heart." Saul loses his army, he loses his kingdom, he loses his position, he loses eventually even his own life, all because of his impatience. You think he would have learned a lesson from this, but very shortly later, when his son Jonathan is going off to battle again, and Saul arrives there and waiting for the Lord to give battle instructions before we march, let's wait for the Lord, and it's growing late and impatient, and it's not going to be good light for the battle, I guess, and so Saul decides to not even wait for the Lord's instructions and march into battle again, and he loses again and again. Like ferociously shaking the ketchup bottle, trying to force the ketchup out and making a mess all over the place, Saul makes a mess of his life. When we grow impatient with God and we try to force things to happen in our time, in our hopes and our wishes and our ways, we just make a mess of life. Abraham and Sarah had received a promise from God that their descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky or the sand on the seashore. They were growing in age. Sarah was well beyond childbearing years. And so, unsure how God was going to possibly keep this promise he had made to them, she decides to send her handmaiden, Hagar, into her husband to conceive and bear a child. And God said, "No, this is not the heir of the promise. This is not the way that I have intended for my family, my nation to start." And with that, Sarah and Hagar and Abraham, they bring conflict into their family, into the family of God, into the people of God, a conflict that some would say we're still wrestling and fighting with today with the Ishmaelites. You see, we can't force God to work in our time. The Apostle Paul tells us in Galatians 4 about the coming of the Christ, and we referenced that earlier in our confession today. When the fullness of time had come, when God's time was just right, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem us who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. You see, the whole Old Testament, they waited for the Messiah. When Adam and Eve had a child, they thought this was the fulfillment of God's promise. When Cain and Abel turned out not to be the fulfillment of God's promise, and they had another one, Seth, the replacement. They thought this one is going to be the one to fulfill the promise. And with every birth of the entire family of God throughout the entire Old Testament, this is the one, this is the one, this is the one. And every time it wasn't the one until the fullness of time had come. You see, God has appointed the time. And at just the right time, he sent the Messiah. The Apostle Paul also tells us in Romans that at just the right time, Christ died for us, the ungodly. At just the right time, Christ died for you and for me. In God's time, he fulfills and keeps his promise. We cannot force God to act. We can ask God, God, will you please cure the sickness? Will you please heal the brokenness? Will you please restore our family? Will you please restore me to a better job? Will you please give me some relief from some suffering? Can you please act? But we can never force God to act. We can only trust that God cares, that God will act, that God will deliver, that God will redeem in his perfect, holy time. In just a few short weeks, I start teaching my high school class about post-millennial predispensationalism. I think I said those words correctly. You don't have to know those terms, but there is this group of Christians today who believe that before Christ can come again, we as humans have to go build a temple in Jerusalem. That we have to do that, and we should be doing that, so we can inaugurate the return of Jesus. I hope you hear how foolish that sounds. Just as foolish as it sounds whenever any of us try to force God to work in our time, in our lives, in ways that we choose or we want. Instead, we give ourselves to God's precious care, to his precious promise, that in his time, he delivers. Good things come to those who wait. May the peace of God, which passes all of our understanding, guard your hearts and your minds, and God's blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please rise for prayer as we wait upon the Lord. Let us pray for all people according to their needs and for the whole Church of God. Lord, in your mercy. Father, thank you for commanding us to stay alert and to patiently wait upon you. Teach us to pay attention to your word and the signs that you are near. Father, help us to keep alert and to patiently watch for your final coming and your time. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus, please help us to faithfully trust and wait upon you and not to run ahead of your time. Thank you for teaching us to be on guard, alert, and ready for your second coming. Jesus, please help us to live faithfully so that we are ready, alert, and awake at the time of your coming. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Spirit, as you do your work in us, we ask for your touch both in body and soul, for the coming of our Lord and Savior for that final time, for the baptism of Haas Noble last night, for the humanitarian crisis at our southern border, for all those struggling with illnesses or losses, for the sick, the elderly, and those we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. For the ongoing pandemic, its variants, and those affected by it, at this time of the coming of preparation of Advent, we also pray for the underemployed, the unemployed, the homeless, and those and all those who are affected by poverty. For our troops, our police, our firefighters, and all those who put themselves in harm's way to protect us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for our country, for world leaders, for civil leaders at all levels, local, federal, and state, for President Harrison, for President Biden, for our Congress, and for the Nebraska legislature. Lord, we ask that you would make them mindful of their position that you have placed them there to manage your creation until you return. Amen. Congregation may be seated for the offering. The congregation will please rise for the Lord's Prayer and the words of institution. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." In the same way also after supper, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it and given thanks, he said, "Take and drink of it, all of you. This cup is a new testament in my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Congregation may be seated.
Now may this true body and blood strengthen you to life everlasting, keep you steadfast in the one true way, faith, as we wait upon the Lord's return. Amen. Let us pray. O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled to constantly serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his everlasting peace. Amen.
You may be seated. Again, good morning. Words of welcome to each and every one of you here this morning. Pray God has blessed you through our time together in worship today. We do have four announcements for you this morning. Announcement number one, Giving Tuesday. So after Black Friday and Shop Small Saturday and Cyber Monday comes Giving Tuesday. And I want to tell you, Giving Tuesday here at St. John in the last 4 or 5 years, we've had a tremendous response, a tremendous blessing Giving Tuesday has been for us in the last several years. So this coming Tuesday, we're inviting, encouraging you again to consider and prayerfully consider how God might lead you to give abundantly. A little extra gift this year for Giving Tuesday. You can give online, find the give button on our website. You can stop by the church office with an extra gift. You can give grain, you can give whatever you want. We'll take it all, whatever it is. But Giving Tuesday is this Tuesday, and you can find in your newsletter more information about the special projects being funded this year through Giving Tuesday. So I encourage you to consider prayerfully how you might respond on Giving Tuesday. Number two, Advent meals. So this Wednesday, we kicked off now the season of Advent. Wednesday night, we gather at 6 o'clock for a meal. This week, our youth group is serving. I don't know what they're serving. I don't remember the menu, and nobody's whispering in my ear. So Wednesday, 6 o'clock, and what's the menu? We don't know. Yeah, so I was hoping somebody would tell me, but Wednesday night, 6 o'clock, come and enjoy the meal, and a free will offering, of course, for our meals every Wednesday. And then announcement number three, join us for worship after Advent meal as we gather back in the sanctuary at 7 for worship. Our theme this year is promises. And with that also, you can pick up one of our devotional books, 30 Promises of God. These devotional books are available in the narthex. That's Latin for lobby. And you can pick up one of these out there. Encourage you to do that devotion with your family or individually or whoever else you like to use those devotional booklets. Those are available in the narthex. Pick one up on your way out of worship today. That will connect with our Wednesday themes this year as well. And then announcement number four. The Wings Annual Christmas Craft Fair is next Saturday from 10 to 3. I got the right time. 10 to 3 with lunch being served in there. Coming out to the parish hall here, we'll have Wings, a lot of vendors coming, crafts available for purchase, including some from your youth group. So check out those as well. All right, this is a holiday weekend, so education hour this week. Usually we don't meet. Are you guys meeting today or no? Nope. So no Bible classes, no Sunday school this week. It is the holiday weekend. So those will resume again next weekend. If you didn't get a newsletter yet, they are available. But all that's all. We're done with all those announcements. So this is the day the Lord has blessed us with. May you enjoy it with your family and friends. And we'll have a moment of silent prayer, asking God to help each of us be more patient and waiting for his time. And not being so impatient and forcing our time. And then after that, maybe you patiently wait and slowly leave the sanctuary while you find other people to patiently visit with. We'll join a few moments first in silent prayer.